thank you very much indeed for your kind words, which truly exaggerate my qualities. But as I say, when you get older, you like to hear people talking good of you. And thank you very much for being invited to this institute, which has an important role in the Serbian and society and the international community. I came to Belgrade for a two-day visit in order to present to the wider society of Serbia the European Public Law Organization, EPLO, an international organization with 16 countries today in its board of directors, and which has Serbia as one of the countries of this organization. So I came to say to the wider society that let us unite forces, let us work together for a better world. The EPLO is not a Greek organization, it is as Greek as it is Serbian. And it is on Greek soil. We benefit from the unique support of Greece. And we also benefit from the unique conditions which Greece has generously offered to the EPLO. We have an infrastructure which has no equal, at least in my country. And we have the benefit of having all of you, your societies, represented in the decision-making and the decision-making level, and also in the scientific level of this organization. As the director said, you will find a lot of information on our website. Please allow me, before I enter the main subject of my intervention, to thank the Greek delegation, which is here numerous today. They happen to be here for a project of cooperation which we have with your Ministry of Justice, the reform of the Judicial Council. And they are all high quality experts coming from Greece to this so hospitable country to exchange experiences and to advance for the acquis communautaire in Serbia. Ladies and gentlemen, I, dear colleagues, I developed this project, this idea of talking of Greece as a state with weak institutions in crisis about 2 years ago, when I was invited to give a lecture in Cambridge, England. And I thought it was my opportunity to say a few words about my country. And my country being in crisis, in those days being in the front page of all newspapers, especially the yellow ones around Europe. And to say a few words about my country, which does not deserve this, because we are not a country exactly like the countries of the other countries of the European Union, at least the countries of the big countries of the European Union, the six or the ten initial countries of the European Union. And that we should be given justice for what we are, not for what people fantasize that we are. And course, I know that I am now in front of another scientific environment. And you know Greece much better than people do in other parts of the world. But I believe that all the same, this subject is interesting to discuss. As you know, we share a lot of history, not only because the mother of the last emperor of Constantinople was Serbian. His name was Constantine XI Dragasi Panellopoulos. But we share a lot of history because we are also united by the very recent and very prominent figure of Rigas Phereos, a man who was executed here by the Austrians on the advice of the Turks, of the Ottomans, to be exact, in those days. A man who wanted a revolution in the name of all the nations of the Ottoman Empire, including the Turks, for a democratic coexistence in a new empire. So those are elements which unite us and which are at the basis of the fact that you know Greece better than any other nation in Europe. However, my main point is that Greece is not the same kind of state with England, France, Germany, Spain or Portugal. As you know, the states, statehood, is an idea which started being developed already in the 12th century and started maturing in the 14th century in Western Europe, when specific elements started being developed by the monarchies of those days. It is generally accepted that the main element, and this is the idea of Max Weber, and everybody is accepting the same idea since then, that the states were developed around a powerful public administration, which was developed by the king in order to be able to impose his will over his feudals around the country. The best known example for scholastic purposes is the example of France, when especially the figure of Richelieu started sending les intendants around the country to represent the king and to rule the country in the name of the king. So the creation of a public administration started gradually in the 12th century and then again in a more mature way in the 14th century in countries like France, Portugal, Spain, England, the German states, or in the Italian states. And so, little by little, they created the states that we know of. There is an exception, as you all know, in what I'm talking about, and this exception was England. England developed statehood, not through public administration, but through the rule of law. It is a very, very interesting example. Public administration in England developed only in the 19th century, and actually they called it collectivism. They did not like it. The unity of the country and the statehood was created on the basis of the idea that the law must be respected by everyone. The element of unity in England was the law. And a powerful king's court, which was itinerary court, going around the country to remind everyone that justice will be done only in the name of the king, not in the name of the feudals. Actually, Henry II, the 13th century, already stepped down from this court, and he asked his barons to step down from this court, and professionals became judges. And professionals spread the rule of law around the country in the name of the king better than anybody else. What was Greece in those days? Nothing. Greece did not exist. We are an ancient nation. We believe that we are the most ancient nation, continuously existing for at least 4,000 years at the same place. But we lost our political autonomy already in the 12th century. In the 12th century, with the Crusades, but also many adventurers of all kinds coming from the West. The East started being infiltrated. Baronies of all kinds were created. Pieces of land were taken by various occupiers. Constantinople fell in 1204, and of course came back to the Roman emperors of Constantinople in 1462. However, it was just the memory of what it was before. It survived up to 1453. We lost our political autonomy. From the 12th century, it means for 1,000 years. We say that we were occupied by the Ottomans for four centuries. The truth is much more complex. And the important thing is that we did not have self-rule as a nation for about 700, 800 years. This does not mean that we forgot who we were and that we forgot that we deserve a political autonomy for ourselves. I was instructed over the flight time how many revolutions were only one area in northern Epirus, how many times they
75.
I don't know, you said that place made 200 in the...
Almost 300.
Almost 300 revolutions. One area in Epirus. But more than 75 times we revolted against the Ottomans. And we tried to gain political autonomy. The revolution of 1821 was successful. Now, the revolution of 1821 had very specific characteristics which we need to remember, and which are very clearly expressed in the Declaration of Independence. What does the Declaration of Independence say? It says that we are descendants of the ancient and wise nation of the Greeks. That's what we believe we are. We are ashamed of the condition in which we are today. And we want to create a state for ourselves which would be similar to the one of the states of the other Christian civilized nations of Europe. That was the mandate of the revolution. Eventually, we became free through international intervention in the Battle of Navarino in 1827. And in 1830, we got an independent state. And a state which was small, Peloponnese and an area just above Peloponnese, and was meant to be weak so that everybody is happy. This state was created ab initio. The Greeks did not want to keep from the Ottoman Empire nothing, any. They did tabula rasa with the Ottoman past. There is nothing which passed from the Ottoman Empire to the Greek state. The Greek state was created as a transplantation of what was called in those days the Napoleonic state in Greece. And actually, for political reasons of all sorts, a regency of three Germans, Bavarians, one of them was Professor Georg Ludwig von Mauer, and his assistant was von Abel. They created, they took a piece of paper and they started writing. Council of Ministers, ministers, local authorities, from scratch. And so we got a state, meaning that our state, if you want to understand our state, you go back, back and back. You arrive in 1830, and then you have to take the plane to go to Paris, or to Bavaria, or to England to understand the institutions, because the history of the institutions are living. They're not. They are the product of history. They are the product of the certain way of thinking of a nation. We wanted to create a state similar to the one of the other civilized Christians, that was the phrase of those days, civilized Christian states of Europe. And we brought the institutions in Greece. But of course those institutions did not have a past in Greece. The Greeks had to learn that you have ministries, that you have ministers, that you have local authorities, that you have a mayor, that you have those were novelties. That you have to pay taxes, that the taxes do not go to the patishah, but to your own pocket, to the state. And we created a state which was not bad and produced results for decades. You know that this state was very poor, because there was the only possibility for the state to find money was to borrow money. And we had already borrowed money to conduct the revolution. Actually, this was the only hope that sometime the foreigners would intervene in favor of us, because we owed them money. And if we did not have a successful revolution, they would lose the money. We had borrowed money from the British. And this state went bankrupt in 1880s. It went bankrupt not because we did not have good people in the government. We had one of our best figures, Harilaos Trikoupis, Prime Minister. But it went bankrupt because Trikoupis wanted to modernize the country. He made bad calculations, and the interest rates changed, and we went bankrupt. In 1909, we have a big change in Greece. The big change is that Eleftherios Venizelos, a Cretan, comes to Athens, is invited actually to come to Athens and take the lead of the country. He becomes prime minister, and in 2 years, from 1910 to 1912, he was able to reform the country, create new institutions, and in those days, the Greek public administration was considered as one of the best in Europe. Just in 2 years, he was able to do that. He brought actually a French delegation, but the truth is that he brought very good people, Greeks from abroad, studying, gave them the government and the directions, and they made it happen. And only 2 years later, in 1912, you remember the alliance we had with you, we started the Balkanic Wars. I mean, a destroyed country in 2 years was able to go to war and win. And then we had a war with Bulgaria, and we won again. And then we had the First World War, and we won again. And then we had the destruction of the Asia Minor, and we were defeated. Destruction means destruction. 1922, Greece was again in its knees. And not only we were again in our knees, we did not have money, because we had borrowed money to make the wars and to make this country bigger. And we had to reform the country with 2 million people having no place where to stay, where to be housed. And despite all of this, we were able to arrive to 1940 and to face the Second World War. My friend yesterday reminded me that not only we were able to arrive to 1940 barefoot for the Second World War, but at the same time we had introduced, we were the first to introduce a labor law, very protective for the labor. We were able to introduce one of the first systems of social security in Europe. We were able to give rights to women which they did not have in the United States of America. We were able to give the right of a vote to everyone. We had done things, but we were bankrupt. So we arrived in this very strange condition in 1940. And we were the only state in Europe which did not surrender to the Germans. First of all, we did not surrender to the Italians. They came from, as you know, from Albania. We defeated them, and we liberated the southern Albania, which actually is full of Greeks. And then the Germans came down, and our government fled to Crete, and from Crete to Cairo. We fought in El Alamein. We fought in Italy, we fought in Normandy. But when the Germans left, the country was destroyed because they had some special attachment in Serbia and in Greece. I don't know. This is something which we share. The country was destroyed, and unfortunately, the country was destroyed. I need to say that openly, because we also had the civil war. And we were fighting against each other up to 1949. In the meantime, thanks to the the treaty of 1947, we got the Decanies. And the Decanies was given from the Italians, the 12 islands around Rhodes, were given from the Italians to the Greeks. And so the territory of Greece that you know dates only since 1947-48. It's a story which you know more or less, but it is very interesting to remind to the Europeans, because they believe that we were there in the 15th century. They believe that we were there in the 18th century, but we were not. And they don't know that we have given our blood. Perhaps we have borrowed money during the decades since 1821 up to today in order to build up a country out from nothing. And not only that, because during the Second World War, our Quisling government passed a contract with the Germans, and we lent it all of our gold to them. We are the only state which did not give, I say that to the benefit of the Quisling government, we did not give our gold to the Germans just like that. Our Quisling government went to Rome along with the Germans and they signed a contract. And the Germans took our gold on a contractual basis with the obligation to bring, to give us the money back with interest after pacification. And actually after the end of the Second World War, they started paying back for a couple of years and then they forgot it. And now they say that they owe us nothing. But people starved to death during that winter when the Greeks did not have money to feed them. So, after the Second World War, we were able in the 1950s to reconstruct the state. And from 1952 up to 1967, we had a very good public administration and the state working despite everything. Despite everything means despite the fact that we were poor and despite the fact that we had all the results of the civil war. People were in exile. It was not easy times, but it was rebuilt. And then we had, in 67, we had the dictatorship. The dictatorship used methods which I can talk about later if you ask me. And they upset the system again in order to impose their will. And in 74, we had the crisis and the invasion of Cyprus by Turkey. They invaded Cyprus and they are still occupying the northern part of the island illegally. And it was a major destruction for Hellenism. They are an independent state, but they are Greeks all the same. And this brought us back once again. After 1974, the Greeks tried to reform the country. It is not true that we did nothing. Perhaps we borrowed money more than we should, and perhaps some money was not used the proper way. This is a big discussion which I want to avoid, not because I'm afraid of facing it, but because it is not the point for our discussion today. The point is that the moment came when we had to face a crisis. Why the crisis started in Greece and not in any other Euro member state? The crisis started in Greece, first of all, not because we lied to Brussels about our capacity of joining Europe. This is nonsense. We never lied to Brussels. Brussels knew everything that we had done in order to comply, and we complied with all the conditions to join Europe. The crisis started in Greece because Euro presupposes reforms and presupposes a certain kind of state. And we needed, in order to have that kind of state, to do reforms. You will ask me, has any country in Europe done those reforms? The answer is no. And you will remember that the first country which violated the rules of Europe was France, when they got an exception about the 3% clause, a special exception, years before the crisis started with us. What was the difference with Greece? The difference with Greece was that our institutions were weak. We had built a country the way we could. We developed the country the way we could. We developed our finances the way we could. And we had to feed our population. And I keep saying that I belong to this generation, which when we were young people, the most of the people in my neighborhood were barefoot. And their sons and daughters today, they have 10 pairs of shoes. Perhaps we owe money, and perhaps we should not have 10 pairs of shoes. But anyway, we would have 2 or 3. This is an achievement. However, the institutions were weak because of the story which I explained to you. And when the moment came, and because we did not reform the country in the specific way which Europe presupposes, we were the first to be attacked by the crisis. We were foolish not to be prepared for that. And eventually we made mistakes into the way to face the problems produced by the crisis. But at the same time, I do not believe that Greece could have done things differently over the years. And I do not believe that the crisis could be avoided unless every country member of Europe had produced the reforms needed at the same period of time. I mean, from 2000 up to 2010, when the crisis starts. Normally, euro should be introduced after the reforms took place. But no country wanted to do that. And I'm very, very curious to see when France will do the reforms which are asked by Greece, or which are introduced in Greece. I'm very curious. I don't believe that they will ever produce those reforms. And I will tell you why I'm sure about that. Because if you take the history of this French state from the 12th century up to now, all the reforms are about the same model. The council of the king becomes council of the state. They work in this way in the period of monarchy. They work the same way, of course, more modernized in the next period. So, to conclude, Greece is a country with a long history, with people who are devoted to the idea of Greece, but at the same time, it is a young country in terms of life of institutions. Number two, because of that, Greece is a state with institutions which are easily possible to be disorganized in times of crisis. Number three, Greece needs to be adapted to the era of Europe because we belong to Europe. And Greece needs to do whatever reforms are needed because of Europe. Number four, all the rhetoric against Greece should stop because it is unfair. We are talking of a country which has contributed and contributes in the development in Europe, and we must be respected for what we have done and what we are doing. And we need a Europe where everybody respects each other. Otherwise, we have a long memory and we can start accusing each other. But this is not the Europe which we want to create. We do not want a Europe belonging to the past. We want a new Europe, a Europe belonging to the future. And we are there. We, the Greeks, to contribute with our best efforts to make a Europe reform. We will always stay in Europe and we will never leave Europe. And hopefully you, the Serbians, will join us soon in this Europe which perhaps creates problems, but it is a good family. Thank you very much for your attention.
We have like 10-15 minutes maybe, and before we start with the debate, I would just briefly ask Professor to finish in some way the, his logical explanation, to give us a brief evaluation actually of reforms since 2009 actually. How do you perceive actually everything that has been going on during the time of the crisis, because today I think we saw that the national debt has increased for, I don't know, 5 billion since that time. And actually, there are still internal debates now in Greece about models of reforms and about the quality actually that has been produced recently. Just briefly, please.
Well, you know, it is difficult to comment this question, but it is easier to tell you my opinion. What I believed, first of all, I need to tell you that I personally have worked in many reforms in Greece during my life. I have the honor to have presided or to be member in committees on all sorts of reforms. And and Greece has the capacity, we don't need the advice of anyone, has the people to produce the reforms needed. And we speak foreign languages, we can read. Or we have our people are well known all over the world in, for their capacity and knowledge and science, etc. What we we needed in 2009-2010 was not to provoke the markets, stay quiet and silent, and start reforming. If we had done this, we could have done a reform our way. But we are very talkative, and we provoked the markets. When we provoked the markets, then we could not anymore stay in the markets. And because we could not stay in the markets, we needed protection by the European Union. And then you have the one who gives you money, who has an opinion about how you should be organized. And they tell you, well, you know, I'm giving you a 5 euro, but you're not going to do this, 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 and this. You need the 5 euro, you sign. And then they say, well, you know, this, 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 and this, which you signed, now it's time to do that. And well, we have, I did not see that. We have actually problems with reforms as signed, some of them as signed, because they contradict our constitution. We have a constitution. Some of them have been declared already by our Supreme Administrative Court, the Conseil d'État, as unconstitutional. Some other times things passed, but there are opinions about about that. So I believe that things should not have been done at the beginning this way. Now we are in a certain stage which is very late to make that a discussion. Generally for Europe, I believe that, and I had expressed that opinion in those days, that if you have a problem because you owe money, you owe money because you have lost your international competitiveness. You produce something which is not competitive with what produce others. So there are things which you can do and things which you cannot do. Europe, for example, has a very important social state. Well, the social state, we built it with money produced by others, in times when Europe was the center of the world. Now we have to maintain our social state with the money produced by us, not by colonialism, for example, or post-colonialism. Europe needs to find a way to be competitive. And of course, I'm sure that the economists have solutions to that, despite the fact that with the time, I'm not very happy with what solutions the economists produce, because they are not proven later. But when you have you have a problem, you'd rather borrow money, send your debt 20 years later, gain 20 years, do the reforms, and be able to pay your debts. If you create a debt problem today, and you try to find a solution through austerity measures, then it is endless. I don't see any. That's my opinion. But this is an opinion which I had in 2009, 2010. And I do not believe that this can now be discussed as a possibility. It's too late. Now, what Europe will do and find the solution to the problem, I don't know, actually. I don't know. But I know that Greeks are a people, a population, a country, a nation which need to be supported, first of all, in terms of, in moral terms, by the rest of the world. And we are a nation, an honorable nation. And we need the attention of our partners so that all of us together solve the problem which is European problem. I will remind you that when all of this started, Greece was, if I remember well, the 2.75 of the European debt. You want to tell me that we were the problem of Europe with 2.75 of the European debt? Perhaps we were. But I will not believe you. But things have happened. That's the problem.
Thank you very much. We have time for a couple questions, so please. Colleague Ibrutinovic.
Thank you for coming and for giving this nice lecture. Looking a few years from now, say in 2020, do you see any positive trends within Greece at national level regarding Greek institutions? Say for welfare state, taxation, other institutions that are relevant to economics, for economic life. Do you see any upward trend, positive trend, that you say that Greece will fare better in, say, 2020 than it is now? Or do you think that the crisis hasn't bottomed out yet? What is your general opinion?
My general opinion is that it was easier to reform the country in 2009, or in 2010, or in 2011, than today. Why? Because the people now are tired. And when they hear the word reform, the only thing that they understand is, well, they're going to take me more money out of my pocket. They understand reform only as losing money. And they have children to educate. They have to live with a decent pension up to the end of their days. So this is the problem today, that people are tired. And this is the reason why my personal opinion is that no matter how harsh or whatever the reforms may be, let us do them quickly and never hear them again. If you ask me if the reforms will be successful, I don't know. This being said, I want to see the others doing the same reforms, possibly before us. And then I will be happy, because I don't believe that they can do in their countries what they are asking us to do. They cannot. You will see it in the upcoming election in some countries.
Thank you. Please. Ambassador,
Professor, you explained that this history of Greece, which is more or less maybe compared with other Balkan countries from the point of view of starting from scratch and then developing several times again from the scratch. But there is difference that Greece was in a European community since 1981. So before this huge crisis started, you were already a quarter of a century inside the EC. And we are now in this process of enlargement, which is more or less about state building, state institution building, more or less. How do you explain that it was not enough this quarter century inside the EU for institutions to become strong and not to be weak, as you say in your title, that Greece is still the weak institutions.
Yeah, that's a very good, a very reasonable question. Thank you very much for asking that question. You need to understand this. We have the fall of the dictatorship in 1974, and at the same time the destruction of Cyprus. And the crisis starts in 2009-2010. In this period of time, especially since 1980, we were able to produce another Greece. The Greece that we produced was truly a revolution, institutionally and societally. We produced, first of all, a new republic. It was not easy. We had a referendum peacefully. We said we are not kingdom anymore, we are going to be a republic. We had a transition from dictatorship and anomaly to democracy. This was not easy. It looks easy, but it was a very difficult process. When I went to the army in 1979, it was written in my papers that I was a member of the Communist Party. So I, 79, democracy. And so I could not become anything more than a simple soldier. I could not enter the offices. 79. And we had to solve those problems because they were coming from the civil war. Just for your information, I was not a member of the Communist Party, but it was written that I was. It was, what was written was the truth, the formal truth. And so we needed to have a Greece for everyone. And this was produced in the 80s. And the 90s. But the production of a Greece for everyone also brought with it certain, how to say, we did not pay good attention to the structure of what we were doing. This does not mean that we did not have reforms. As I said, I have participated in very important reforms. I was the president of the reform producing the code for the administrative code, the administrative procedure code. We created a new code for local authorities, a new code for regions. We transformed everything was transformed, perhaps not in the best way. And as I said, we had to solve all the problems of the past, find answers, and create a state for everyone. And there, perhaps we borrowed more money than we should. Or perhaps we should not have organized the Olympic Games. There are many perhaps. The point is that and that was my main point, after all, we needed to create a better Greece. Much of this, we did it through the European Union. Perhaps we could have paid more attention to our obligations. But I repeat, we should have done differently in 2009, 10, 11, differently. That's what I believe. And I believe that Europe should have done differently. Europe at a certain moment had a debt, and we were only 2.75%. So it was a common problem. It was not, it was easy to tell in the yellow pages of newspapers of Europe, oh, the Greeks, they don't like to work, they are thieves, they are corrupt, they are, it's easy to say those things. But the point is that when you have a problem, the problem is common. You are in the same family. And now, it was nice to say that Greece was the problem, but at the end of the day, it is a common problem.
Okay, we have two small questions, and we are about to finish because we have to go on further. Mr. Bulatinovich, Minister of Defense.
Thank you. When it comes to economic crisis and reforms, usually the first place where you cut expenses is defense. From your point of view, how do you estimate the strength of Greek armed forces after several years of economic crisis and budgetary restrictions? Do you think that they're capable to defend your territory and, of course, to perform more loaded duties within NATO and to provide security to your Greek community in Cyprus too?
Well, thank you very much for the question. If you see all the voting of the parliament on the budgets since 1974, I mean, since the Republic was restored to the country, the budgets are voted in favor only by the have been voted in favor only by the parliamentary majority, the governing majority, except the chapter for the defense, which traditionally has been voted by all the parties. I will tell you that we are in the unfortunate position to have to defend the borderline of the European Union only on the basis of our budget. Our borderline is also the borderline of the European Union. And we pay all the expenses us. It's us paid. And we believe that the cost should be paid by everyone. I had the honor to be the minister of my country for a few days, and those few days were the days of the crisis, of the peak of the crisis with the refugees. And my position was, all right, we're not good enough to keep them outside Greece. Why don't you come? Protect the borderline yourselves. You are better than us. Do it. Do you want them to die in the waters? Let them die in the waters. Who is going to pay the bill? And I remember saying, behind all of this, you also have the issue of defining the sovereignty of Greece, which is the sovereignty of the European Union, but only on the expense of Greece. Do you know how many times per day we have to send the planes up in the air to stop others invading the European Union? Our President of the Republic made a declaration about that just a week ago. Who pays the bill? We do. We would be happy that our creditors pay part of it.
Thank you. And finally, colleague Zajcevic.
Thank you for your lecture.
Professor, there is so much similarity between Greece and Serbia history, and also we had some conference here in the Institute of European Studies about the Greek crisis, and we talked about the causes of this crisis a lot. But I want to see you, to ask you, after all this crisis, are the Greek people attached to the European Union, to the European integration today? And do you think you can decide to leave, for example, European Union, like British, or it's not in your agenda?
Well, this is a difficult question because I don't know what the Greeks will do. You know, we are a sentimental people. And sometimes we take sentimental decisions. I will remind you that in 1453 we said we prefer to go with the Ottomans rather than with the Westerners, because the Westerners wanted us to become Catholics. And we did not want to become Catholics. See? And so with the people you never know. However, the mandate of the Greek Revolution of 1821 is to be there. And people like me, personally, will never betray the mandate of the Greek Revolution of 1821. People have given their lives. People have suffered for this country to be free, politically independent, and to be with the nations, the Christian civilized nations of Europe. Now, we have to be able to develop policies to make it happen. And the Europeans need to develop policies, not to put the Greeks to decide sentimentally. As for us, I don't believe that we are going ever to abandon the heart of Europe. We belong there. We believe that we are one of those nations which produce the values which should be the heart of Europe. Do they want us out? Let them kick us out. But we will stay there. That's what I believe.
Okay. It's time to finish. Professor Flogaitis, thank you very much for your lecture.
And, thank you very much. It's been an honor.
See you again.